So in this video, we are going to discuss about the memory hierarchy. And in this entire memory hierarchy, we have the on top, we have the CPU, and CPU is the master device and it is the fastest component. So here we have CPU, which is the fastest component as compared to any other device. Now, the CPU generally is combined with some registers. So from here to here, you can see I've combined this CPU with some processor registers, and these processor registers are very close to the CPU and they are very close to the speed of the CPU. So that means if you see, if you go from this direction to this direction, if you go from here to here, then the speed of these devices will increase, the size of these devices will decrease, and the cost of per unit storage will increase. Now here, these processor registers, they are super fast, they are super expensive, as well as they are very tiny in terms of storage. Generally the processor registers just store some bytes, they are not even of kilobytes. Then the second component, which is very close to the CPU, are the cache memory. And you can see the cache memory are fast, they are expensive, and they are also very small in capacity. Generally the L1 cache on general home based computer systems, it is of somewhere around 512 KB. The L2 cache is somewhere around 2 to 3 MB, and the L3 cache is somewhere around 6 to 12 MB, or you can say it is 6 to 12 MB. So from here to here, these three devices are the cache memory, which are comparatively, they are slower than the registers and they are faster than the main memory. Okay, and then the next hierarchy here is representing the main memory, and the main memory is generally we call it as RAM. So you can see generally we call the main memory as RAM. The main memory is a fast device. It is, you know, it is less expensive as compared to the cache memory or the registers, because registers are the most expensive devices, and it is of average capacity. So somewhere around, on our general systems, we have somewhere around 4 GB to 16 GB of RAM, which a normal person uses. Okay, and this RAM is of two types, that is SD RAM or DDR RAM or DDR SD RAMs. Okay, after this we have solid state drives, which are also called as SSD drives, and these SSD drives are you know, faster than your hard disk drives, which are HDD, which we call, and they are slower than the RAM. And these SSD devices are also comparatively expensive. Generally if you go to the market at this current time, if you go to the market, it is 250 GB of SSD will cost you somewhere around 7 to 8,000, and if you buy a 500 GB of SSD, that will cost you somewhere around 15 to 16,000. But if a hard disk, if you buy a hard disk, then 1 TB of hard disk will cost you somewhere around 4,000 rupees only, right? So, but the major benefit is SSD is very fast as compared to the hard disk. Hard disk is there where a disk rotates, and disk rotates somewhere at a speed of 5400 RPM to 7200 RPM. If you are from a computer science background, I guess you understand this, what is 5400 RPM, what is 7200 RPM. And again, in the next videos, we are going to explain these speeds also. And when we discuss about this SSD, then SSD is not having any disk which is rotating inside it. It is a solid state drive, but it still, it can give a performance which is somewhere around 5 to 6 times faster than hard disk. Okay, these are 5 to 6 times faster than hard disk. Okay, now we have all these, you know, levels of hierarchy, all these levels of memory. And here some of these memory allows random accesses, some of these memories allow sequential accesses. For example, if you discuss about the cache memory, the main memory, then these cache memory and main memory allows random access. That means you can access any data from any location. if we have magnetic disk as a secondary memory, like if we have in secondary memory mechanical devices, we have magnetic disk. Now these magnetic disks are semi-random. So magnetic disk means I'm talking about the hard disk drives. And if we have magnetic tapes, which you don't use it nowadays, we use hard disk drives, but still, if we discuss about the magnetic tapes, then magnetic tapes allow sequential access. Okay, now the purpose of this memory hierarchy is to bridge the speed mismatch between the fastest processor to the slowest memory at a reasonable cost. Let me give a simple example of this. If you see, this is representing the CPU, okay? And CPU is the fastest device. Okay? And this is your hard disk. If you discuss about the CPU and the hard disk, then hard disk is a very slow device. Now, in this particular case, CPU is a fast device, hard disk is a slow device. Now, if the CPU has to communicate with the hard disk, that means to execute a process, CPU has to bring that process from the hard disk and again store the data inside the hard disk, then here the bottleneck will be the hard disk. Bottleneck. When I'm saying bottleneck, you can see, why do we always give an example of a bottleneck? And sometimes you must have read in gate examination paper or usenet papers that there's something called as bottleneck. You can imagine the bottleneck like this. If you have a bottle like this, okay, and you are, you know, removing all the water inside from the bottle. Now, if we have two bottles like this, the first bottle is not having any neck. So that means if you invert the bottle, then entire bottle will flow like this. And here the entire bottle will flow from this neck only. Now, what do you think? Which bottle will get emptied first? So you can clearly see here, this will be emptied first, and this will take some time to get emptied because here this bottleneck is creating some restrictions. Okay. In the same way, CPU is a very fast component. The hard disk is a very slow component. Now, if CPU has to wait for hard disk to give the data to it so that it can process the data and then can store the data inside the hard disk. So here the bottleneck, the hard disk is acting as a bottleneck because CPU has to match the speed of the hard disk. Even though CPU is a very fast component, you can say it is 1,000 times faster than the hard disk, but it has to match the speed of the hard disk, which is again going to bring the speed of the performance of the entire system to the performance of the system will go down in this particular case. So to remove this kind of limitations, we introduced this concept of memory hierarchy. So what is a memory hierarchy? The fastest device is a CPU, we already know. Now to the CPU, we have given some registers which are very fast and which are as fast as the CPU. And then we got something called as a cache memory. And then we called something called as a main memory. And then we got something called as a CPU. Now, the data which is most frequently referred, right? Like they are referred like life, right? So that the data will be stored inside this register. Now, after that, the data which will be referred less number of time as compared to the register, that will be stored inside the cache memory because they are very fast to access. Okay, so you can imagine it like this. If there's a person and he has to perform some task, and there are two tools he uses. Number one, he may be using a screwdriver, so assuming it is representing a screwdriver, and second one, he may be using a hammer, so this is representing a hammer. But the thing is, he uses hammer once a month and he uses screwdriver every day. So what can, now if he needs to find that hammer or the screwdriver inside the house, because this is his workshop, so maybe this is his workshop and he needs to work with these items, and this is very less space which is available. Now If he needs to find the screwdriver every day, then he'll keep it in front of his eyes, because he should, so that he can easily find it and he can easily access it. And if he requires a hammer once a month, then he can store that hammer inside storage so that it will not take enough space. So he will be able to save some kind of space out of it. So that is why in the same way, the CPU can access the cache, and to access the cache, it can directly access it. It is a fast memory, so it is the CPU is going to store the data which is very important in the cache memory, and then the data which is less important, or you can say the data, see, obviously the data which is stored in main memory and the second memory, that is also important. But the thing is, what is the data which is most frequently referred? Okay. And then some data will be stored in the main memory, and then some data which will also be stored in the secondary memory. Now, when we discussed about these two subjects, that is the operating system. We discussed about the operating system. Now, in case of operating system, again, we also discussed about the memory management. Memory management. If you remember that subject, if you remember the topic of memory management, you understand that this memory management, we discussed about two topics, that is contiguous memory allocation. Contiguous memory allocation. And second one was non-contiguous memory allocation. Non-contiguous memory allocation. Okay. So before referring this topic, I'll prefer that if you have not referred that subject or that topic, please refer it first before going through this entire topic. So in case of contiguous memory allocation, we studied something called as fixed partitioning, and the second was variable partitioning. And in case of non-contiguous memory allocations, we discussed about paging, we discussed about segmentation, we discussed about paging with segmentation, we discussed about inverted paging, and we discussed about the TLB, that is the translation lookaside buffer. Now, when we discussed about this entire non-contiguous memory allocation, in the non-contiguous memory allocation, we have taken two things. Number one is the main memory, and second one is the process. And this process was called as virtual address space or logical address space, which is having logical addresses. And the main memory was called as physical address space or physical, which is having physical addresses. And as I told you, this division between these pages here, because this virtual address space was divided into pages and this physical address space was divided into frames. And when I taught you this topic, I told you that this pages and the concept of pages and frames, it is not the case that we have done a physical division. We have done a logical division, so that we will be able to manage the memory properly entirely. Okay, so you can say this in case of main memory and this process, we discussed about the virtual memory mapping. So here we discussed about what is virtual memory mapping, and now in case of computer architecture organization, we'll be taking these two components in the major detail, that is the cache memory and the main memory. And here this cache memory and main memory is based on a hardware, or you can say processor cache mapping. Okay, so again, let me just brief you here, so if it is not clear. Now if in case of operating system, if there's some processes here, then we discussed about the process and the main memory. Now in case of computer architecture organization, we are going to discuss about the cache memory and the main memory. Cache memory and the main memory. So we are going to divide this cache memory into something called as cache lines, and we are going to divide this main memory into something called as blocks. And there are three major topics here that we will be studying for mapping these blocks to the cache lines. That is, number one is direct mapping. Number two is associative mapping. And number three is set associative mapping. Set associative mapping. So direct mapping, associative mapping, and set associative mapping. So we are going to discuss about these things one by one. So before that, we'll be discussing about the cache memory first. That means this cache memory is actually divided into multiple parts. We can have a L1 cache, we can have L2 cache, we can have L3 cache, that is level 1, level 2, and level 3 cache. And we'll discuss about what is the time taken to access these cache, or you can say what is the average time taken to access these cache memories. Okay.